Okay, once again, a very good evening to our guest of honor, Ms. Judith Halim, ladies and gentlemen. Okay, let's start off by giving thanks to Father in Heaven for making this series of events possible, and also our guest speaker, Ms. Judith Halim, yeah, and the sponsors, as well as all invited guests here for taking time out to this evening to attend this event. Okay, indeed, we are deeply honored. Okay, kindly allow me to run through the program for today. Okay. We will start with an opening speech by Mr. David Poe, someone whose name needs no mention. He's the founder of this non-profit organization, God is my CEO, in short, GIMC. There will be a presentation by World Vision International, a humanitarian relief organization dedicated to working with children, families, and communities worldwide. Followed by our guest speaker, Ms. Judith Halim, will deliver her speech on wisdom in leadership, entrepreneurship, and wealth creation. Last but not least, there will be a Q&A session. Okay, without further ado, let me introduce Mr. David Poe, who is the CEO and Managing Director of Asia Wisdom Group and DP Group of companies which are all real estate. Heaven and heaven, welcome. Just intro, relax, relax. I know he's very eager to start, but just let me finish through everything, okay? Okay, there's a very, just one paragraph of introduction for David, okay? Early this year, David has a calling to do something to give back and bring glory to God's name, hence founded GIMC to advance God's kingdom. Being a business leader, entrepreneur, and investor, he feels the importance of Christian values as the compass in our daily life. Past the birth of God is my CEO and all of us here this evening. With a warm applause, let's invite David up on stage for his opening speech. Ladies and gentlemen, please help me welcome Mr. David Poe.
Thank you, thanks. Good evening, ladies and gentlemen, good evening all of you. Let's do it better this time. Make me feel that I'm welcome here. Good evening, friends. Good. All right. Okay, we are here. Okay, we're here for some good purposes. Now, for those who want to find out more about what is GIMC, this is actually left on your seat. You can actually read through in a free to get to know us better. Of course, you can also visit our website at www.gimc.com.sg. Now, okay. Well, we're now running to the second year of our GIMC event. I'll just probably go through quickly on what we've done in the last 1.5 years. Okay, we organized a lot of management, wisdom series management talks, right? So we invited a lot of speakers, some are CEOs of certain companies, some are bosses, some are managers. They are here to share on one common purposes. Okay, that's to say, how they actually apply God's values in their, whether is it leadership, management, entrepreneurship, or simply wealth creation process, right? So we have in the past, we have this honor of God opened this door for us. We have Singapore richest man, Mr. Philip Ng, the CEO of FAIS. He came down to address the audiences, okay? He spoke about how he actually applied God's value into his, the management of his company, so-called being a richest man. I'm quite sure he has a lot of wisdom from God that how he actually run his business, right? Then, later on, we have Mr. Lim Siong Guan, the group president of GIC, one of the biggest company, or you can say what, it should be the biggest, maybe one of the biggest company in Singapore, right? So, Mr. Lim came down, he shared about how he's managed his team over the years, again, using God's value, right? Next, we have Mr. Teo Kim Hock, the CEO of OUE. Okay, he came down. I'm quite sure, because I've seen some of your faces many times, so I'm quite sure many of you are here for the past few events, and you remember, right? He's saying that how he actually prayed for God's guidance, and he used that guidance in many of his company's investment, and he made millions. God bless him, right? Now, of course, we also have Sister Ai Boon, the CEO of ABS, Association of Bank of Singapore. She came, right? And there are many things that she shared. We have one brother in this room who just shared with me that he was very touched with Sister Ivonne sharing. I know she shared many things. And one particular thing I remember she said she was so hot-tempered when she was young. And how God changed her from such a hot-tempered person that she can be such a patient manager. And many of her staff worked for her for decades. Okay? So, how God transformed her, right, in her management role. Now, these are some of the events we have hoped in the last 1.5 years. Now, the question to ask is, why GIMC? Why do we have GIMC? In short, for God is my CEO. Right? Now, the drive to have this GIMC comes from when I see instances like, for example, I told you, for those who attended the first few talks, I told you, if someone wants to make a fake LV bag, I'll tell you God will punish you, but you want to make it, someone will buy it, God bless you. You are accountable to God. But I cannot tolerate someone who makes a tainted or poisonous milk powder that when a baby drink, the baby will die. That is not tolerable. How can we allow this kind of thing to happen? So, when we, in the course of making money, have we hurt anyone? Have we damaged anything? Or for the worst, have we killed someone? So in the course of our wealth creation, whether you're an entrepreneur, a boss running a company, a manager running a team, right? Or maybe just for wealth creation, maybe you're just an investor. Again, do you apply God's wisdom? No, you saw again recently the so-called one real estate agent run away with 60 million, right? Then they found it's a Ponzi scheme. Now, how can all these people fall into this Ponzi scheme? Because they did not invest using God's value. God say you pray for His wisdom, but they are driven by greed. Their investment are not centered around God's value. The investment is centered around greed. When someone promised such a high return and they believe, if you pray for God's wisdom, God will tell you this is ridiculous, impossible. Don't believe. But they're driven by greed. That is why they lost millions. Now again, whether you're a manager, an employer, employee, or just an investor, in the course of creating your wealth, have you applied God's value? Have you used His words? That is why GIMC is all about hoping that we will not see poisonous milk powder in the market anymore. Right? Now, tonight I'd like to share a story, a Chinese aviation story, to illustrate how important is GIMC, having God as our CEO in our work, or in our creation of our wealth. Now, I got hold of this story through the internet. It's a report made on this Chinese aviation industry. It was all the airlines and all this, air freight and all this. Now, this guy, he was trying to send his dog from one city to another city, air freight his dog. And when he sent it to the air freight center, they weigh his dog is 54 kg. Okay, 54 kg, I think a huge dog, right? Don't know how huge. But the thing is, for some reason, his dog was killed. Not delivered, killed at the airport. So they, of course, I don't want to go into this, whatever parties involved say, oh, because the dog never behaved himself, trying to bite or whatever, trying to escape, so they shot the dog. Okay, so this one I don't want to go into it. So, obviously, the owner become very sad. So in the midst of trying to so-called settle the paperwork and all this, he realized one thing. Why when I go and weigh my dog's 54 kg, but then, in the document, it only states 16 kg. Hey, what happened? I thought they weigh my dog is 54. Document says my dog is only 16 kg in weight. So he went to prop and he discovered a lot of things, and many experts came out to say this is real, this is true. What happened was this, in the Chinese aviation industry, the air freight company will charge you the full rate, for example, okay, it's 54 kg, they'll charge you 54 kg. Now let me, maybe I'll show you this, maybe it's easier for you to understand. So let's say you are Tom. You send this to the air freight company, maybe for a 54 kg freight. Sorry, I think this part is blocked. 54 kg. But the air freight company, together with the airline staff, air freight got to use the aircraft to fly, right? So air freight company, airline staff. Either the boss of the air freight company himself, or maybe the boss is innocent, but the staff are involved. The staff here, or the boss here, collaborate with the staff in the airline department that take care of air freight. They say, let's declare 16 kg. 54, Tom paid freight for 54 kg, but the air freight company only paid the airline for 16 kg freight. Of course, probably they split the difference. And the worst thing is this, the pilot of the aircraft took off thinking there's only 16 kg on board, but actually he fly with 54 kg. Let me ask you, if it's one piece of cargo, what is another 30 kg to a plane? But can you imagine if all the cargo go through the same process? 16 ton will become 54 tons. And in the report, a lot of experts, even pilots say, this is very rampant in the Chinese aviation industry. It always happens. Every day, part of pilot parcel, the job. And one pilot even said, that is a reason why, sometimes when you go and fly, when you are supposed to land, the landing looks very smooth, slowly. But all of a sudden, when you hit the ground, it's a bang. One of the pilot being interviewed said, this is the cause. Because we took off thinking it's 16 kg. So we actually time our landing according to the weight that we have. But end up, we turn up to the aircraft becomes so heavy when they land. So it boom, when they land. Can you imagine? If the weight is too much for the plane to carry, and the pilot not knowing, but the pilot will not know. Because the pilot will fly according to the build that they have. Oh, this 16 kg can. Doctor up. Safe, I can fly. The pilot is innocent. If you think it's over, you think you'll fly because his life is at stake. But he's innocent. The worst thing is, another 300 lives on plane are also innocent. There are those who pay for air ticket. Now class, can you imagine if one day, indeed, in the report it says a few flights crashed because of overweight problem, but I don't want to name you the flights. Because I do not know whether all these are proven or whatever. The thing is if this thing continues, one day, one aircraft going to start crashing, because it's overweight. Because the pilot thought it's 16 kg, but they are having 54 kg in the sky. But class, why does this thing happen? Because of greed, right? Because of money, right? Because it's a huge profit. For whatever the customer pay, you rip off 70%. It's a huge profit. I mean, for those involved. Now class, all these things happen because of greed. All these things happen because they don't have a God to govern them. They thought they don't have a God to govern them. Now, class. Why this thing is so rampant in the Chinese aviation industry? Why not SQ? Why not Cathay? Why not United Airlines? I'm not saying that Singapore don't have, US don't have, I'm not saying that. But they probably have more in the Chinese aviation industry. Why? I always believe in this. Chinese, you like it or not? People around our age, sorry, I'm only 25 years old this year. Okay. All right. Our generation, okay? You know, during the Cultural Revolution, no one can believe in religion. So actually, most of the Chinese grew up without religion. They don't believe in God. They only have one thing. The law can punish you. But what do the Chinese think? So what? The aircraft crash, never mind. What? No, I die. What? They die, no, I die. Or police will catch. They may not know it's me. What? Or even if they know it's me, never mind. I can pay and walk out. No problem. No, in China. I should not say that, but you know. In Chinese, you can pay through and solve every problem. So what? I pay, never mind. I can solve the problem. They are unlike you and me. Why? Because you and me know. Even if the law don't punish me, God won't punish me. He knows I'm makan this 34 kg, 30 kg away. He knows. He will punish me. That is why you maybe see it less in the US, in Hong Kong, in Singapore. Because you and me, we know there's a God we must account to. So you see how important is GIMC. If we can spread this thing beyond even Singapore, if we can reach more Chinese, we say, please, we need to make money. Please use his values. I think the world will be a safer place. I think you and me can fly safer. So this is what GMC is all about. one of our purpose. Now, one of the solutions to resolve this, we make sure we continue to spread GIMC. God is my CEO. When I make money, I look at me and say, God, can I make this money? He said, yes, I'll do. He said, no, I don't think. When I manage my team, I ask my God, have I treated my team well enough? When I invest, I ask God, am I greedy or I'm doing the right thing? GIMC can solve this problem. One of the solutions. Now, let me show you also some ugly side of Singapore, because it cannot be always Chinese. We also have a lot of rotten apples over here, just maybe less. Now, let me show you in the last few months, I pick up some. Former exec jailed for forging firm's checks. So we have, we also have a lot, who don't have a God as a CEO. This is how they make money. Of course. Everyone is innocent until they're convicted. But this is what I pick up from the newspaper. More, mastermind who staged fake accident. Who fake accident and get insurance claim. Jail. Again, this is how we make money. But this is forbidden by God. More, director to pay 9.6 million penalty for insider training. Obviously. Right? As a director of a public company, you owe an obligation, owe a duty of care, but you make money for your own self, ignoring shareholders' interests. Right? Secretary took nearly 5,000 from law firm. Is this the way you want to make a half a million? She can make, but she also must pay for it, because God can see. Dual try to cheat firm with forged checks. Same thing. Right? This is the problem. We also have an ugly side over here. Now, one way of achieving GIMC, one way of getting God to be our CEO, right? There are many ways, The Bible teaches you thousands of ways, right? But I'd like to suggest one way today, one way. Now, this is actually a verse from the Bible. This is from King Solomon, 2 Chronicles, chapter 1, verse 7 to 12. Let me read out to you. This is one of my favorite verses in the Bible. That night, God appeared to Solomon and said to him, "Ask for whatever you want me to give you." Solomon answered God, "You have shown great kindness to David, my father, and have made me king in his place. Now, Lord God, let your promise to my father David be confirmed. For you have made me king over a people who are as numerous as the dust of the earth. Give me wisdom and knowledge that I may lead these people. For who is able to govern this great people of yours?" God said to Solomon, "Since this is your heart's desire, and you have not asked for wealth, possessions, or honor, nor for the death of your enemies, and since you have not asked for a long life, but for wisdom and knowledge to govern my people, over whom I have made you king, therefore wisdom and knowledge will be given you. And I also give you wealth, possessions, and honor, such as no king who was before you ever had, and none after you will have." Now, what is this all about? When God asks Solomon, "What do you want?" Solomon never asked for wealth, never asked for long life, never asked for his enemy to be killed. He only asked for the wisdom and knowledge to manage God's people well. Now, why is wisdom important? Wisdom is important. Look, in view of your wealth, wisdom is important in everything, in all parts of your life. But let me just focus on your wealth creation process. Now, if you are an employer, entrepreneur, you must have the wisdom, right? To make sure you manage your accounts well. You know how you're going to pay your staff, right? Are you sure you got enough cash flow? So you must manage have wisdom to manage your cash flow well, your financial well. You must have the wisdom to manage your marketing well so that they'll go out and get more sales for you. You must manage your HR well, right? So your staff turnover is lowest, right? As a manager, okay, you're not a boss, yeah. But maybe I'm just a manager, oh sure. You manage 5%. It is 5% giving the best for you. Or you just exploit them, get results, and you kick them away. Or you make sure you take care of them, you make sure you develop their potential to the fullest. Or I'm just an employee, never mind. Did you give your best to your company because he can see what you do? He'll be here to judge you one day. Or worse, in the course of your work, do you take bribe? Do you receive kickbacks? Which is forbidden by him. Or as an investor, did you invest wisely, or you think there's free lunch and you're driven by greed? So wisdom are important for all our wealth creation process. Now in a wealth creation process, I feel that there's two processes. One is you are in control. So you need the wisdom to do it well. For example, right, as I said, for entrepreneur, your first process will be managing your cash flow well, your financial well, your marketing well. So you need wisdom to manage as well. But the second process, which is not in your control, what is it? The results. You're not in control. You mean David? Who said I'm not in control? I'll prove to you. Does it mean that when you work hard, you will get rich? No one. Then God will bless them. Those uncle, aunties sweeping along the street for the last 12 hours, you mean they will all become millionaires? No, right? They work very hard, right? Why? Because it's not about working hard. You need God's blessing and grace. So the first process you're in control, so you better have all the wisdom, to pray for all the wisdom to make sure I do it well, my financial, my marketing, everything. Second process, which is not in control, which is in God's hand, the results. You also must pray for the wisdom to submit all to Him. So it's all about wisdom. If I'm investing, yes, you have the wisdom again. Oh, I better learn about Forex before I go into it. I go and attend classes. I go and talk to the expert. Yeah, you're in control. You better have this wisdom to do it well. But does it mean when you invest, you make money? What if tomorrow there's a little bit brother again? Are you in control? You're not in control. You pray for blessing and grace. But you must have wisdom to pray and submit to Him. So there are two processes. Everything you need wisdom. You need a lot of wisdom in the creation of your wealth. Whether what you are, what do you do? Now, God promises to deliver, but we also must do our part. Now, God say, I will feed the bird, right? But He said, bird, just open your mouth, I'll drop the worms in your mouth. No, right? He said, I will feed you, but make sure you fly out and look for your worms. I will feed you, yes. You can look for your worms. He didn't say, you stay there in the nest, open your mouth, I'll drop. No. So God promised to deliver, but you must do your part. Please use your intelligent faith. I've set this example. Let me use it again tonight. Let me use a very simple story to tell you to show you what's intelligent faith, what's blind faith. God bless you, but God wants you to use your intelligent faith. Example, tomorrow your son is going for exam. You can choose to use blind faith. Son, tomorrow exam, you pray lah, tomorrow shall pass. I pray for you also, tomorrow shall pass. You can go and play computer game, you can go and sleep, tomorrow shall pass. This is blind faith. What is intelligent faith? Son, you pray so tomorrow you can pass. I also pray for you. So that make sure tomorrow, God bless you, you can pass. But tonight you study hard. Before you go to bed, you study hard, understand? You know how you pass tomorrow. That is intelligent faith. God promised to deliver, but you please do your part. You please do your part. You open your mouth like that, the worms will not drop down. You do your part. All this are wisdom. All this are wisdom that you can learn from this very, very great man, the greatest. Learn from him. Pray for his wisdom. So that you continue to create wealth. In his words, so he will light up your path in your leadership, entrepreneurship, and wealth creation. Right? Now, that's what I want to share for tonight. But before I invite the next speaker, GIMC, we have also gone into a mentorship program. We are so glad to have Miss Ashley Low, who has agreed to take up this mentorship program. Right? She'll be the mentor for this program that we're going into. Now, Ashley, she graduated from England. She's currently a managing director in the European Bank in Singapore. She found Christ in 2005, and she witnessed God's intervention in her husband's life, and her faith just grown stronger and stronger and stronger. Now, we've started this mentorship program once a month. Because mentorship, so it has to be small, cannot be for like 200 people tonight, okay. It has to be small, maybe 5 to 10 person. It's a work marketplace mentorship program, means Ashley will be in the room with you, maybe 5, 8 of you. We'll provide lunch because it's lunch hour. So we'll provide maybe lunch boxes, bento, while you eat. You can share and pour your problems in the marketplace. And Ashley will try and give you opinions, advices on how you can overcome this by applying God's words. So it's wonderful. Wonderful. And Ashley has agreed to do this. I'm so grateful to God. God has opened this door, and thanks to Ashley. So that in any case, if you do not know how to deal with your boss, jala la hawa, Ashley can give you some advices from him. So we are starting this mentorship program. Hopefully this can help many of you who has problems or challenges in your workplace, marketplace. Now, we're going to do this because we cannot do it with limited people. Now, do me a favor. I'm so sorry. Maybe it's a bit too small. Okay. Now, for those in this room, we'll give priority to this room first. Because we can only take 5, 8, 10% max. For those who want to attend this first marketplace mentorship program, now you take out your smartphone now. You just key in this code MMP. MMP, marketplace mentorship program. Key in your name, your email, and you text to this number now. Let me write over here in case it's too small for you to see. Okay, now. Nine two four eight one one eight. Take your smartphone now. Give us this code MNP, your name in an email. Text to this number now. Now we cannot invite all to this session, because as I said, I can only have 5, 8, 10 next. So if 20 send me the text, I can only give to the first 5 to 10, first come, first serve. So even when you send a text, don't just come on a day. We cannot accommodate so many. It will not be effective if it's over 20, 30 people. Look out for a written text. If you are selected because you're the first 5 to 10 that send in this to us, we will send you a reply in the next 1 week and say you'll be invited. Please come on that day. The place will be 10 Anson Road, International Plaza, hex 12-12. 2nd July, Thursday, 12:30 to 2 p.m. So don't worry about taking leave. You can drop, probably you work nearby here, walk across to International Plaza, we serve you lunch, while you munch, you throw your problem, Ashley will mentor you using God's words. Right? But please wait for the reply. If you don't receive a reply next 1 week, please don't come. Maybe we'll try and keep you for a future session. So we're going to start this, right? God is great. Now, next. Right? Before I hand over to the next speaker, I need something from you. Now, what do we need? We need volunteers, right? GIMC is set up as a non-profit organization. At this moment, it's self-funding, plus we have some very good and faithful sponsors. Thanks, God. That's how we can have this place, how we can serve dinner. You know, the $5 registration we collect from you can't even pay for the dinner. The dinner itself, one box is $10, because we have to order from the hotel. A bento is $10 because it's hotel food, not kopitiam. Okay. So the $5 can't even cover the food. One box, $10, you only pay $5 to register. Right? The $5, I was telling people, somebody asked, why $5? Since it's, you want to sponsor. The thing is, if I don't put a $5 for registration, many of you will come for a free dinner and go home. Right? Oh, come eat, go home. So, you know, make sure you are really sincerely here for the talk, genuinely here for the talk. Okay. So, for those, now we need volunteers. Okay, we need volunteers, so that you can help us in our future events. Okay, we also need donation because they are all self-funding and from sponsors. So if you can give us some donation, we will be very, very appreciative. Or if you can be a sponsor, for example, David, I run a convention center. Next time you use my room for free, oh, thank you very much. David, I run a catering company. Next time I sponsor dinner. Thank you very much. Now, if you can give us any of this help. Again, SMS your name, your email. If you want to become a volunteer, give us your name, email, and put in volunteer. So we know, we'll put in a volunteer list. In future, we call you up for some volunteer service. But of course, if you say, no, David, I'm not trying to be a volunteer, I want to give you a donation. Then you put in donation in your SMS. Okay, my staff will call you and see how you can help us. Or if you want to be a sponsor, put in sponsor. So we know, when we receive your text, we'll call you to see what you can help us in what area, right? And for this text, don't send here. Send to another number. Let me give you this number. You send to 8322-7971. 8322-7971. Anything you can help, just text us. So we know we're looking forward to see you soon. Right? Good. Now, next. Some of you may be familiar, some of you may not be familiar, but very soon you'll get familiar with World Vision. Right? These are some of our sponsored children. Pardon me, for those who have been here for the last few sessions, I told you, right? I'm going to keep on telling you about World Vision. Every session you come, so I told you, you want to come, you better be patient with me. I'm going to keep on telling you about World Vision, because I know there are a lot of children outside need help. They need help outside. Okay. Now, what is World Vision about? Let me, share how I started. Now, 10 years ago, I'm still not a Christian. I accepted Christ 5 years ago. This is the best decision of my lifetime. At the time, I was still not a Christian. I was actually another religion. I went to Crawford Place, Bing Crawford, what do you call that? You know Borders Bookshop? Borders, Wheelock. So there's a table outside Borders Bookshop, and one guy, one woman stand there, and I walk forward and I said, what is this? That's so interesting. Then they display a lot of children photographs. Hey, it's interesting. And I said, what is it all about? They say I can sponsor these kids. Oh. So I start to sponsor one. And one become two, two become four, four become eight, nine, I got about 10, 4, 13, 14. Okay. Now let me tell you this, this journey is wonderful. How wonderful? You start sponsoring them when they are maybe about 8 years, 9 years old, plus, minus. And the good thing is, every year, they will send you a progress report of that kid one day. And every year they'll send you the latest photo. You see every year the photo, wow, grow taller one day. You see what this guy grow taller, right? Very good at this boy. And I tell you what, it's so good, no? You better do it for your children. You know why? Because you can write to them and they can write to you one day. And I tell you what, they live in such a remote part of the world, they got no email one. You use letter writing. So I think it's a good way to train your son how to do letter writing. Ask your son to write to them. You must really write the letters on a pen and pen, pen and paper. And they'll write letters to you on it because no email. It's so wonderful that you communicate with them and somebody listen to what they say. It's so wonderful. No? And I tell you, you sponsor them year by year. By the age of about 16, we should write to you and say, this guy or this boy is independent now, 16, he can probably start working or whatever. You don't. You can choose to sponsor another child or children if you want to. And the good thing is you can even visit them. You can visit them there. Once a year, they organize for you to visit them. If you don't mind that kind of remote area, please go and see all your sponsored kids. This is a wonderful journey. The thing is, at what cost, David? Let me tell you at what cost. Let me ask you one thing. What can you do now with $45? It's not even enough for your one family meal, right? Unless you go McDonald's, I always say, unless you go McDonald's. If not one family, how $45 you want? Not enough for even a family, but this $45 can give them so much one month. $45 can give them in one month, one whole month. Schooling, clean water, medical care, teaching them economic skills, and World Vision. Are you here? Oh, what is that? Food, water, education, clean water, healthcare, and economic lifestyle. Okay, economic livelihood. $45 a month, you get that, you give that boy so much thing in one month. Don't you think it's very, very meaningful? What can you do with $45 in Singapore? But that can give them so much in one month. Now, class, let me say this. All of us, including your children, grew up with choices. We have plenty of choices. Let me tell you what choice our kids have. Your son can choose between Nike or Adidas. Agree? Your daughter can choose between iPad or Samsung Note. Correct? You choose for your kid. Hua Chong or Nanyang. We all grow up with choices. Plenty of choices. So many choices. Don't like Adidas, don't like Nike, still got New Balance. But I tell you, this poor kid has no choice at all, no. Not a single choice. Because you're born there, you will remain poor forever, you work there. Because their parents is a farmer. If they're born there, they become a farmer one day. They take all the parents. Class, give them a choice. Honestly. I think it's a bit too late to help this current generation. Why? Because they only know how to farm. Let's be honest. We want to help them, but let's be honest. They only know farming. They cannot work in a bank. They cannot work in an engineering firm. But I tell you, if you give their kids a choice, they can choose to go to school. One day, their kids can be a banker, can be an engineer, and that will help them break the poverty cycle. Give them a choice. Our kids have too much choice. But they don't even have a choice. They're not choosing Adidas or Nike. Yeah? They only choose, uncle, can I have a pair of shoes to wear? That's all. They're not choosing between Hua Chong or Nanyang. They only say, uncle, can I go to school? That's all. Why do we give her a choice? They only asked to go to school, no. They didn't ask for Nike. They only asked for a pair of shoes. And I tell you, the urge to go to school is so much over there because they probably never got a chance in their lifetime. Some of the kids, because they live in such a remote part of the world, every morning they must walk 2 hours. They must walk 2 hours to school. No? 6 years old, 7 years old, walk 2 hours to school. Where got school bus one down there? After school, they walk 2 hours back home. Just because they want to go to school. Class. Give them a choice. They need you. Now, as I said, it's across religion, races, languages. When I started doing it, I'm not even a Christian. Anyone can do it. Plus, you can pick which child or kid or children you want to sponsor. You can even pick from the country. You want to sponsor Africans, Mongolians, Chinese, anywhere, Indians. Do it. Right? And I tell you, you can never believe that previously when I heard about it, I said, huh? Like that also can. In that part of the world, children are still dying of diarrhea. Huh? David, you can't even see how diarrhea can die one man. Those children are dying because of diarrhea, no why? Because they got no medicine. Diarrhea, no medicine, they die. How poor thing, man. Help them. Please help them. For $45 a month. Now, for those who can even afford more, World Vision has many programs. One of the programs they have is they're trying to help families build a home in Cambodia. Cambodia, right? They're trying to help families build a home in Cambodia because they don't even have a proper shelter. No? When the rain comes, they are drenched. No? That's kind of home they have. So they are trying to build homes for all these families. And I tell you, in Singapore, if you want to build a bungalow, it's at least $1 million. But they're not asking for that. People in Cambodia just want four walls and a roof. And I tell you, it only costs $5,000. US or Sing, sorry, 5,000 US or Sing? Sing. It only costs $5,000 Sing to build a home for them in Cambodia. So for those who can afford it, stretch out. Reach out to them. Help them. Now, okay, I'm going to invite, be patient with me for the next 15 minutes. I'm going to invite Fiona from World Vision to share with you exactly what is World Vision. And of course, if you have any questions, you can also ask her, right? Before we invite Judith on stage. Now, let's welcome Fiona from World Vision first. Thank you so much. Thanks. Thank you.
Thank you so much, David. As David has already mentioned, we are motivated by our faith to help all people, regardless of race, language, or religion. My own sponsored child is in the Middle East. He's a Palestinian Muslim, but it doesn't stop me from helping him because they are very needy there. So where there are needy children, that's whom we help. How do we select needy children? Well, these are the areas and the communities that are identified by national stats as earning less than one, their households earn less than one USD per day. So based on that, we would be already looking at a few parts of the country that have this profile of impoverished communities. And when we work together with the village leaders to identify who in the communities are truly needy of help, these could be widows, these could be farmers where they both work, but it's not enough because of climatic changes, etc. They can work very, very hard, but they are still not able to provide year-long access to food for their children. So this is where we would help, and it's not because they are lazy. In many of these cases where we select the families to help and the children to help, it would be because they also have a vision for the future for their children, and they are willing to make that sacrifice, work hard, pick up economic livelihood skills in order to better provide for their children. These are the people that we help. So the stats that we put out, beyond these numbers, I think I won't read out the numbers, but the reality is that we're looking at 400 million children living in poverty. In yesterday's newspaper, talks about how In spite of making progress, it's still grim news for the poorest of children in the world. Why? Because although you're looking at huge falls in lower statistics, lower numbers in the number of children who are in abject poverty, the numbers have to do with the easy to access children. What about the invisible children? What about the street children who are trafficked, who are subject to pedophiles, etc.? These are the realities out there, and some of them are not even in these statistics because they're invisible, they're not counted. So these are the people that we still have to help. Why? Because at that time, they can't help themselves. If we don't step in and stand in the gap, then these are human beings. If we can do it to little pets, why wouldn't we do it to a fellow human being who is just unfortunate enough to not be born in Singapore, to be accessing PUB clean water, to have the legacy of LKY. So these are sobering thoughts. 121 million children between 6 to 15 have never been to school. So many of the children that we help are in the rural area. And these are the countries that we help from Singapore. So later on, if you want to select children to help, you would be spot for choice, so to speak. This is a short video on the work that we are starting in Nepal. Belinda Lee is one of our World Vision ambassadors. And this video was shot before the earthquake. After the earthquake, 90% of the homes in the areas where we help, they are all in critical condition. The children are outside. They don't even dare to step into the school because it's so unsafe. They don't sleep inside the home because it's so unsafe. So we are definitely very needful, and they are very needful at the moment.
Help! They need help. So are you willing to help them? Bless them, because, you know, because we are so blessed ourselves. So when you are blessed, why not be a blessing to someone else? I'm actually very excited about this trip because it is my first time going on a World Vision trip because I just got appointed as a Google Ambassador for World Vision. I brought a lot of goodies for Pramila and her family. It's like a whole bag of fleece jacket. I made a very special gift for Pramila. It's gonna be awesome. I'm so excited to meet her and her family. You know, a lot of my friends, they are World Vision sponsors, and I only came on board a few months ago, and I could never understand the kind of excitement that they had when they were sponsoring children. And I could only listen. But now I'm one of the sponsors. Deep down in my heart, I know that I'm not just helping one kid, I'm helping an entire village. And you know what? It's not about the money, but it's really about having the desire to want to do your part for the society, for the poor, for the underprivileged. And this is what I think sponsorship is all about. It's not just about one person, but it's about the whole community. You know what? Throughout the trip, I thought to myself, oh, Belinda, you're this, you know, travel host. You know, you've been there, done that. You've seen it all. You wouldn't be feeling too much. I was wrong. I was overwhelmed.
Belinda.
Oh! I got emotional. I did. You know, she lives high up in the mountains. I live in a city. I live in a first world country. She lives in a third world country. It's a big difference. Just by giving her that sense of hope, knowing that someone cares enough to want to bless her and her family, I sincerely hope that when she grows up, she remembers that, oh, someone has helped me before. And I want to grow up to be someone somebody who can be a blessing to someone else. I know that they are struggling. They've got like 6 children in the family. Their old house was destroyed by a landslide, so the dad had to go loan money to build a new house. He's heavily in debt. And in order to clear those debts, he has to go loan more money from someone else. How does he survive? How does he make sure that he keeps his whole family full and happy? And, you know, it's difficult. But what happens after that? But how? Well, she lives here. What can we do for her? I want to do more. What would help is that we get a lot of sponsors to come into the village, sponsor every kid. Then something happens.
Yesterday we were in Sindeli East and we had to drive 2 hours or 3 hours, or walk 3 hours up a very steep mountain. The terrain is extremely difficult. So imagine that you're pregnant and you're having to walk straight up a mountain in the heat of the sun to get health care. That's a huge issue here. The number of birthing centers are few and far between. For that reason, and also culturally, women have tended to give birth at home without any help. So right now in Nepal, only 36% of women give birth with a skilled birth attendant available. That means over 60% are giving birth at home. Our NGO partner goes from village to village, building awareness, you know, urging women who are pregnant to go to clinics. They give them basic health information. They talk to them about nutrition, because nutrition when a woman is pregnant is incredibly important, both for the health of the mother and the child. We're also, at the same time, we advocate for an increased number of birthing centers. Education for children in Nepal is a real challenge. As you know, yesterday we were up in the mountains, and those little children have to walk over an hour, some of them, to get to school. Over very difficult terrain, narrow roads in the rainy season, the roads get washed out. It actually becomes dangerous to go to school. We're very involved in early child development. That's preschool is up to the age of 6 in Sindeli. And that's really important, because what we found is that when children have a positive experience of education before school, they're much more likely to learn and be more willing to learn in school. Education is ultimately the responsibility of the government. World Vision does step in when needed to build classrooms, provide toys and books and educational materials. So that's another piece that we do. Finally, World Vision spends a lot of time in raising awareness with teachers. We actually train teachers in how to do child-friendly education, so to expand the way they teach. So why are we doing this? Why are we building schools and providing equipment and toys and games and training teachers? Why are we building awareness with parents and children? It's because we believe that education provides children a way out. It provides a hope for a future, and it gives them a chance at a better life.
So, this is just a snippet of what we are doing. And it's the same model that's replicated in different parts of Asia. And the model is we help 30 to 50 villages at one go. That is about 100,000 people. We ring fence it, we identify needs, we implement programs, and then we phase out. And the reason why we phase out is we do not want to create welfare states. We just want to empower them to a point where they can sustain themselves. And it is possible to do that with the 5 critical areas of help that David was talking about. The food, water, health, water, and education. And you can see that this approach works. On the ground level, when we help parents, when we help mothers teach them about health education, what to feed their children so the kids are not just growing up on rice water when they are too young and they become stunted and anemic, this is where we are lowering the malnutrition levels. In Thailand, we don't just help during the harvest time, give them drought-resistant seeds for their rice farming, flood-resistant seeds, but we also teach them other ways of supplementing income, like feeding catfish, like growing frogs. And these are the other ways in which we are helping them for food security, with the irrigation canals, with the mushroom farming. and access to water, access to schools. When I talked about just now about how we are helping children on the streets of Vietnam, Cambodia, Mongolia, what we really do is to create a way in which they pick up vocational skills, they can earn an honest living, they are also able to learn how to be a bit more savvy rather than just be picked up by traffickers. We are also training their community, the police, etc., so then they are also on the alert. So it's a whole community approach that will help the child. And in terms of Christian witness, as you know, we're motivated by our faith. And in different parts of the world, we do partner with Christian organizations who also have the same focus that this is one way in which they can teach, for example, the kids in their community about child protection skills, about how they need to respect and love one another, about how they can extend forgiveness. These are just very, very basic, but the basis of that is fundamental Christian values. And of course, we do not proselytize, we do not tell them about Christ. There are churches inside our areas, and if the parents agree, yes, they go to Sunday school, but it is never voiced or forced upon them. And the kind of Christian witness that we do is by deed. The churches, we know what the churches do, it's by word. Ours, we are inspired by our word to do the work of reaching and helping the poorest of the poor, unconditionally. So in Mongolia, we have servant leadership and team building seminars. In China, we also do some of that about servant leadership, because that's different from the other types of leadership, we believe. And how child sponsorship works is when we pool the resources together to build the wells, the clinics, the hospitals, so your sponsored child will be a direct beneficiary of the clean water, but then the neighbor also is a direct beneficiary. So this is what we mean by the community-based and yet the child-focused approach. So you help one child, really you also help the community. And what to expect, we give you annual progress reports, you can write, you can receive letters, and basically, our call is very simple. Children, they do have dreams, but beyond, they can't. Some of them are just too thirsty to dream. Some of them are just too hungry to dream. But if we give them the very basic, we believe we can unlock the potential. And the Cambodia projects that we're talking about, this is before reconstruction. Something like this, when it rains, the mother with all her kids are just so busy moving from one part of the house to another, just mopping up and mopping up. And the before and after is obvious, and it's 5,000 a house. So build a home, bring up, and build up a child. It costs so little to impact so much. So without further ado, thank you so much for your attention.
Okay, thank you, Fiona, World Vision representative, for your speech, for sharing as well. Okay, so if you're keen to contribute to a good cause, you can do so later at the World Vision booth at the back, or speak to their representative. Okay, this evening, we are honored to have a speaker whose experience and background is well suited to deliver the topic on entrepreneurship series. Okay, she's the founder and business owner of an F&B business in Singapore, and most importantly, a woman whose heart is for God and His people. Let's hear from this accomplished woman on how God, her CEO, has guided her in entrepreneurship and in life. I am pleased to present Miss Judith Halim.
Good evening, friends.
Good evening.
Thank you, David, GIMC, Angela, and thank all of you for having me here. I just want to share with you a little bit about my background. Yeah, I came from Indonesia, Medan. How many of you have been to Medan, you know, Lake Toba? Yeah, that's where I came from 22 years ago. I was an Indonesian, but now I became Singaporean. Thank God for that. Okay, so I just want to share with you a little bit on my background again. I came from a very poor family. My father abandoned me when I was 18 months. I had two elder sisters, so the whole house is like, you know, all girls. And back then, 40 over years ago, in Medan, a small little town where I live, if you don't have a man at home, it's a very shameful thing. People look down on you, will say that, you know, you are a fatherless child, you know. So with the political instability, it caused us even more fearful, whereby we have to hide at home when there is riot. We have to buy lots of canned food and then rice and then packet noodle, and we just hide at home. So that's how I grew up. I was so poor. I was looking for a redeemer, someone that could redeem me out of my situation, out of my poverty, out of the life that I thought was unfair to me. At the age of 20, I met a Singaporean man. He do business in Indonesia. And then when he looked at me, I was only 19. He looked at me, he said that, "I think I fall in love with you." So what do I say? And he said that, "I will, you know, give you a good life. I will bring you to Singapore and, you know, I will provide for you so you will have no worry about your finance and all that." So what do I say? Yes, right? Yeah, so I said yes. And after I said yes, he said that I got a sickness. I'm hemophilia. How many of you know what is hemophilia? Okay, hemophilia is a direct opposite of leukemia. Leukemia is lacking of a red blood count in their body so that they need to inject a red blood cell, right? Hemophilia is lacking of white blood count in their body so they need to inject a white blood cell in their body, okay? So as a hemophilia patient, if you're sick, you practically have to lie down, you cannot move, okay? And you cannot knock yourself and fall because there will be internal injury, you know, so and so, okay? He's 1.8 high, so that whenever he's sick, I have to carry him, okay? Shower him, you know, clothe him and do all stuff. So do I still say yes? Wow, you all are so wise. I was blind, but now I see. I said yes, got married. To cut the story short, 6 months later, I got pregnant. And I know that if I have a baby boy, my baby boy will be a hemophilia. If I ever have a baby girl, the baby girl will be a hemophilia carrier. So that next time if my baby girl have a boy, the boy will be a hemophilia. So what do I do? He said, "Let's try. Maybe out of the 99.99999%, we are the 0.00001, the lucky one." The Hokkien say, "Kai pok." So I say, okay, let's try. In Indonesia, we learn to submit to our husband. So I submit. I continue with the pregnancy. At the 8 months of pregnancy, I cannot travel anymore. So he said, "Go to Singapore. Go and give birth in Singapore so that your baby can become a Singaporean." At that point of time, I already know that it's baby girl, so I thought, I'm safe. So I built hopes, I built my dreams, you know, I'm going to have a happy, happy family, happy home. But the day when my baby girl was born, the doctor say she discovered three complications. The first one was she had three holes in her heart. The second one was because her right ventricle is very thick, preventing the blood and the energy circulation to go to the upper part of the body. That's why she developed brain damage. The third thing is she is a hemophilia carrier. I was only 20. I couldn't take it. And I said this to myself. If there is God, I want to know why life is so unfair to me. As a mother, what we wish for is a healthy child, correct? But I was deprived of. As a child, what we hope for is to have a parents at home that we can call dad and mom. But again, I was deprived of. But bad thing doesn't stop there. The doctor say that your baby is going to die. He will die, she will die anytime, okay? So I cannot go back to Indonesia. And when she reached first month, her dad came back to Singapore and looked at her, and this is what he said to me. I think we are not meant for each other. I said, huh? What do you mean that we are not meant for each other? We got married now that we have a child, and then the child is sick. And, you know, I cannot go back to Indonesia. He didn't say anything. He left the next day, left me and baby in Singapore, alone. No money, no relative, don't know how to speak English, don't know how to speak Mandarin. A foreign land that I know not of the culture, I know not of the people, I know not of the language. What do? Quietly, I book a ticket. Quietly, I fly to Indonesia. Quietly, I stepped inside my house and I saw there was another girl. A third party, using our helper, using our driver. My heart was broken. I cried and I cried and I cried. All hope is gone. All my dreams, all my future is gone. Without even staying, I booked my ticket. And I waited in the airport, I cried and I cried and I cried. I was sitting at the bench. And I said this, if there is God, I want to know why life is so unfair to me. I cried and cried and cried, and suddenly I saw a woman walking past. She was wearing a cross, like what I was wearing. As she walked past, I remember, when I was little, someone ever told me that if you call upon the name of Jesus, He will come and save you. So I call upon the name of Jesus. I said, Jesus, if you are the true living God, come and meet me halfway. Because I don't think I can live another day that I couldn't even lift up my head to walk and to breathe without feeling a pain, because it is just too painful. Life is just too painful. I came back to Singapore, everything is gone. What do you do if you're in my shoe? No money, sick child, cannot go anywhere, too ashamed to tell my family back then. What would you do if you're in my shoe? Sorry? Suicides. You are so wise. Yeah. That was my only option. I rented a small a room, HDB small room, 14th floor. I jumped down, die or not? Sure die, right? 14th floor? Yeah? So that's my plan. I plan with my baby, since the doctor said that, you know, my baby is going to die anyway, okay? So I plan to jump down from the 14th floor together with my baby. But God's plan is higher than my plan, and His ways are higher than my ways. That afternoon, around 12 o'clock, I wrote a letter to my mother to say that I'm sorry, I want to end my life because I couldn't take it anymore. And I plan, I want to go out that evening. I want to buy a nice piece of gown for myself and for my daughter. And the next day, we plan to jump. Want to die also must die pretty, right? Yeah. So that was my plan. Around 2 o'clock, an insurance agent called. Is there any insurance agent here? I thank God for insurance agent. Insurance agent called. He said that I heard from one so-and-so that, you know, you have a baby, you know. If you buy an insurance policy from me right now, the Chinese say, 很划算. I said that, no, I'm not going to buy. I don't have the money to buy. Okay. Oh, you know, without further ado, I want to put down the phone. And then he said, I heard from the other side. He said that, hold it. He said that, tonight, there is a special speaker in my church. Can I invite you to my church? And then I say that this insurance agent must be mad, right? From want to sell me insurance, and then now, you know, want to invite me to a church, okay. So I think, I plan to buy a nice piece of gown, right? But I don't know how to go around in Singapore. I'm not familiar with Singapore. So I said to him, I can follow you to a church, provided you bring me to buy gown. The insurance agent must be thinking this is another mad woman, right? But he said yes. So he came and picked me. We went to a church. Guess what? It is English service. I don't speak English. I don't understand English. Okay? And church is something that is very foreign to me at that point of time. Because all my life, I worship all other things rather than Jesus. I'm not familiar. The worshiper is singing, and then the pastor is preaching. I couldn't even concentrate at all because over here, it's so painful. The pain is excruciating that I couldn't even breathe. Because every breath that I take is painful. The pain of betrayal. The pain of being abandoned and dumped in a foreign land. And I just want to end it. I said I want to go home. Okay, I want to just end it. From the stage, at the end of the service, the pastor was asking people to come forward for prayer. Obviously, I didn't go out because I don't even know what they're doing. From the stage, the pastor pointing at me. It's quite a big church, about 2,000-3,000 people. Yeah. He pointing at me, he said, that woman at the last third row, that woman with a baby, I wanted to come forward. I didn't even know that he was calling me until ushers came from the left and from the right and they pushed me out. I came out on the stage and he prayed for me. He said this to me. He said, whatever your situation is, you will get through it. You will get out of this situation, not just to become a better person, but a servant for the Most High God. I still don't understand what's going on. And he asked me if I want to receive Jesus as my personal Lord and Savior. At that point of time, I saw the whole entire auditorium was red in color. I cried and I cried and I cried. I don't know who is Jesus, but at that point of time, what I felt right here, a peace that transcends beyond understanding, a peace that 20 years living, breathing, and walking on this earth, I know not of. So I said to him, I don't know who is Jesus, but if Jesus that you are talking about is equivalent to this peace that I'm experiencing right now, I need it badly. I cannot do without it. I received Jesus as my personal Lord and Savior at that point of time, and I cried and I cried and I cried. I cried until I'm so tired, I've forgotten that I want to buy a gown, you know? And then suddenly this insurance agent and the couple from don't know where appear again, okay? And I said, come, faster bring me home. I'm very tired. I went home, had a good sleep. I had severe depression. You know, severe depression, people, they don't sleep. I can don't sleep for 5 days. But I'm still walking and functioning, okay? But that night, I slept so soundly. And the next day, when I wake up, my normal usual day, when I wake up, I will go to that window, the small HDB window. I look up and I'll curse the day that I was born because life was just too painful and just too unfair for me. But that morning, when I wake up, I walk to that window. As I look up, the same sky, the same scenery, the same tree, but something is different. And I begin to say that, hey, how come this world can be so beautiful? This is a world that I know not of. You see, friends, at that point of time, nothing has changed. My baby was still sick. The father still ran away, don't know where. I still have no money, right? It's not that today you receive Christ, tomorrow you become rich, right? Does that happen to you? If that happened to you, hallelujah, yeah, but that doesn't happen to me, okay? Nothing has changed at that point of time. But God has changed right here. And God has changed me right here. Friends, I just want to encourage you. If you want your situation to change, you got to allow God to change you right here. You got to allow God to change you right here. Then your situation will follow suit to change. So what do? I pick up that letter that I wrote to my mother to say that I'm going to die, to say that I'm going to end it. But this time round, I said to myself, I am not going to die. I am going to live. I'm going to live for people who appreciate me. We have to accept there are people that no matter what we do, they will not appreciate us. So what do? We put them aside. We live for people who appreciate us. And I'm going to live for my daughter. And as I begin to touch, right here, where is that pain? That pain is gone. Just like that. So I say, I'm going to live for this Jesus that can heal me and take away my pain, just like that. But I still got no money, right? I still need to eat, right? My child is still sick, right? I took up the courage, I called my mom, I tell her everything, I said, come to Singapore, since I cannot go back, you come to Singapore, take care of the child so that I can go to work. I thought, it's okay, I start all over again, I will find a job. Okay, in Singapore, I studied law, never finished, only 1 year. So I thought maybe I work in a lawyer office, do some admin work or do some clerical stuff, okay, can or not? Can, right? They say I don't need an assistant that don't speak English, you know. So I say, okay. Maybe I lower down my expectation. I go and be a normal staff. Can or not? Cannot. I lower down my expectation some more. I go sell McDonald's. Can or not? Can or not? Can. Okay. They say no. I try Kentucky. Also no. Let you guess what is my first job in Singapore 22 years ago. Maid. What else? Anything else? I share with you. Okay. I was a security guard in F&N Coca-Cola. Do I look like security guard? Maybe back then I really look like one. Because it's the recommendation through the agent. He asked me, what can you do? I say I can only speak Bahasa Indonesia and Hokkien. He said, okay, I put you there. Okay. I was so poor. I only earned $2.80 per hour. Working 8 hours per day, minus 1 hour lunch, 7 times $2.80. My daughter was so sick. I cannot survive. I cannot make ends meet. I was so poor until I can only afford 1 meal a day. If I take lunch, I don't have dinner. If I do dinner, I don't have lunch. Don't talk about breakfast. Breakfast at that point, at that point of time, to me, it's a luxurious item. But God is a big God. He gave me a promise in Joel 2:25. He said, I will restore to you all that has been eaten by the locusts, the swarming locusts, the crawling locusts, the big and the small locusts. He said, you will eat in plenty and praise the name of the Lord your God who has dealt wondrously with you. For my people will never be put to shame. What do? I hold on to that word of God. Because I know what He said, it will come to pass. It will never return void. I hold on to that verse. Pray and pray and pray and pray. Opportunity came. My supervisor looked at me. He said, what do you do there? Can I send you for English course so that at least you can be a receptionist? I said, of course, yes. I went for English course. I became a receptionist. And then after that, they said, I send you for another course again. Okay. I go again. Okay. And then I became a normal administration clerk. And then end of assignment, my agent took me to and put me to another company. They look at me again. They say, what are you doing there? I send you for another course. Okay. I studied again. Within a span of 6 years, I was made from a security guard to receptionist and then to administrator, from administrator to assistant manager, from assistant manager to manager, from manager to senior manager, from senior manager to general manager, from general manager to a managing director. And from a managing director, finally, God gave us a business on our own that we can glorify God through the business. Amen. If you ask me, what did you do? Must be you're very hardworking. I will tell you yes, because God say in His word, a little bit of folding of hand, your wealth will go away. Just like what David said. Right? But if hard work can pull you through, you will see a lot of hard workers, they would have made it. We need God. We need His peace. We need His love. We need His grace. So my life was, my career was restored. What about my daughter? My daughter was healed from the heart. She's now 22 years old. No operation, no medication. And then I met my present husband in a church. My handsome. And now, we already got married for 14 years. So my life was restored. I want to share with you, okay, when I was a manager, how I started this business called Olive Vine, okay? Yeah. I was the managing director of a fashion company. I was serving in that company as a, you know, for seven years. I was so happy there. You know, fashion industry are very glamorous. You do buying trips, you go for a fashion show, and then, you know, every day, high heels, sit in a nice office, you know, smell very nice, long hair, you work with all fashion designer, yeah? Every day wear nice, okay? I was so happy with my job, okay? One day, God say, go, flee, now, do not turn back. I say, huh? I'm very happy here, you know? You ask me to go, flee now and do not turn back. The company love me. I love the job. They give me car. They give me, you know, a share and all that. He said, go now, flee, do not turn back. What happened to those people who God said don't turn back and they turn back? They became pillar of salt, right? Correct, right? So it was very clear. Go now, flee, do not turn back. I said, my goodness, okay, how am I supposed to go, you know? At that point of time, my husband was just recuperating from a brain cancer surgery. I will come back to you that story, okay, at the end, yeah. He's not in working, okay. No insurance want to cover him, okay, and no employment. I was the only income earner. I came, you know, I said that, my husband, God say, go, now, quit, flee, do not turn back. So how? I was expecting him to say that, wait now, maybe wait for me to recover, I go and look for a job, right? Then you quit now, right? I was expecting him to say that. He looked at me. If God calls, you go. I said, huh? Go ah? 吃什么? 吃西北风啊? Okay? And he looked at me again. If God calls, He will provide. I say, 笑了啦, this time. Okay? I tender my resignation. I need to give 3 months notice. I was so busy handing over, okay, traveling here and there. I don't know why I didn't look for a job. And nobody approached me also. Nobody headhunted me also, okay. Come 31st March was my last day of employment. 1st April, totally no job. Huh? I was at home. Dare not to wake up, you know. I was already awake, but dare not to open my eyes. Okay, suddenly the whole world is so quiet, nobody look for you. Your phone never ring. Your email used to be you on your computer, hundreds of email waiting for you because you're very important people, right? Everybody look for you for solution, okay, and all that. Yeah, people are queuing for you. Suddenly quiet. Nobody look for you. I have identity crisis. Who am I? Why the whole world is so quiet? Dare not to wake up. Already conscious, already awake, but dare not to open my eyes because I know at the moment when I open my eyes, I have to face the reality. And I say that, God, it's April Fool, you know, today. If I hear wrongly, that's it. I was at my prime time. 35 years old. I say that, you know, what did I do, you know? A good job, and then I just quit. Yeah. I say, if I hear wrongly, I'm dead doomed, you know? You want to know how I pull through? Without getting depressions. Before I open my eyes, I already wake up. Before I even open my eyes, I will say this. I trust the Lord with all my heart. I lean not unto my own understanding, but in all my ways I acknowledge Him and He shall direct my path. I wake up, I go to the shower. I trust the Lord with all my heart. I lean not unto my own understanding, but in all my ways I acknowledge Him and He shall direct my path. I go and make my breakfast while cooking. I say, I trust the Lord with all my heart. I lean not unto my own understanding, but in all my ways I acknowledge Him and He shall direct my path. I walk on the... No, nothing to do at home, kia lai, kia ki, you know. Every day, I just got all my heart. I didn't know how to my own sleep, but in all my way, I know and He shall direct my path. My poor husband and my poor daughter will look at me. Suddenly they will, you know. But that's what I do. I will quote that, I will shout that out. If I need to shout that out 200 times a day, I will do it. If I need to do that 300 times a day, I will do it. If I need to do it 500 times a day, I will do it because I refuse to let negativity or depression come to me. Because I know, the Bible says, faith comes by where? Faith comes from where? Faith comes by the hearing, and the hearing, and the hearing, and the hearing by the Word of God. The more I speak, the more I hear, the more faith come. The more I speak, the more I hear, the more faith come. I do that for 3 weeks, like a crazy woman. My mother always say, you crazy woman. I say, it's okay, it's better for me to be crazy for God than to be crazy for this world. Hallelujah. 3 weeks, day in, day out. I just love from my heart. I lean not out of my own heart, but in all my way, I know to me. I usually direct my path. 3 weeks. One night, 3 a.m., cannot sleep, man. Right? Jobless cannot sleep. Okay. 3 a.m. God say, you want to do business? I say, yes, of course I want to do business. You do F&B business. I say, huh? F&B? I don't know how to do. I don't know how to cook. I'm not the type that know how to cook. I don't go to kitchen and cook. So, F&B? No lah. Okay, fashion can lah. I do fashion for so long I can. He say, if you know, who gets the glory? I say, huh? Quite true, huh? Our God is so wise. If everything you know, who gets the glory? So I say, okay, I wake my husband up. Husband, husband, husband. God say, do business. He say, do lah. And I say, F&B business, you know? He say, do. I say, how to do? I don't even know how to cook. How to do? And he's, you want to guess what he say? So wise. And look at me again. If God calls, He will provide. The second time I say, siao lao this time. So to cut the story long, to cut the story short, okay, everything was downloaded so clearly, including the menu, the price list, what type of food that I'm going to sell, and the location. The first location that was given to me was, he said, Bugis Junction. I went to Bugis Junction. Look for the directory. Many restaurants, many eateries. I count all my savings. One and only place that I can afford is in the food court. The rent is $38,000 a month. Bugis Junction. I count. 3 months I don't make it, I will go in bankruptcy. But God say go, and I will bless you. So the two of us, at home practice. Practice mushroom soup, okay, practice, okay, this, practice that, okay. Come 1st September is our opening of the stall. Okay, very stressed, you know. 10 o'clock supposed to open, okay. I cook mushroom soup, I already practice at home, correct? Yeah? I see the fire, I got scared. Three burner ring is so big. Then I see my pot. I got scared. 9 o'clock, 10 o'clock, my shop's supposed to open, right? 9 o'clock, I cook soup. The soup burnt chow ta. I don't know how to control the fire. What do I do? I want to cook rice, okay. My mother will tell me, you want to cook rice very easy, okay? You just put your rice, put your water, then you stick in your finger, it doesn't cross this line, that means it's very good, okay. You know the rice cooker is how big? It's this big. How are you going to put your finger in? It doesn't work, okay? The best joke, okay, is this. You know the deep fryer is this high, it's so big. My entire life, I have not seen this machine before. Contractor say, this one very easy, idiot proof. Just switch the gas on, tap, it will work. Okay? Okay? That morning, I put in the oil. I turn on the gas, tap, my oil is black color. I'm going to open shop, the shop is going to open at 10 o'clock. I say, contractor, faster come. You know, this machine has spoiled, okay? And I'm going to open shop, so you have to come fast, you know, yeah. Then the contractor came. He looked at me very angry. And then he looked at the oil. He looked at me. You first time, ah? I said, yes, I first time. I've never seen people like you. Okay, I say, okay, what's wrong with me? Of course, your oil is black. You never even tear the plastic sheet. And you put in your oil and you turn on the gas. Of course, your oil is black. You know the commercial kitchen machine, they all have a one plastic sheet that they attach to it. You need to pull it so hard to them. How do I know I'm supposed to do that? I've never seen this before, you know? And then come 10 o'clock, the shop opened, customers start to come. All the people that I employ, I go and cook. I don't know how to cook, boss. I say, huh? During interview, you say you know? No! now you say you don't know? He said, yeah, I don't know. In the interview, everything know. Okay, now everything don't know. So what do we do? I have no choice. Suddenly I be standing right in front of the grill, the griddle. I become the grill cook. My husband have no choice. Standing right in front of the stove, suddenly become the pasta chef. But actually the heart like customer come, we also scared. We don't know how to cook. Customer don't come, even more stress. No income. What do I do? I tell you, I cried and I cried and I cried so much, you know. Every day got to work 16 hours. Cut the vegetable until my hand cramp like this. Spending 16 hours until my toe swell like this and refuse to go down, you know, for 6 months. Every day, I'm oily, I'm smelly. Then I remember those days, perfume, high heel, working with designer, you know. I say, God, if I am a, you know, your daughter, you are the king of all kings. If I am your princess, why did you make me go through this, you know? When you need to grill a chicken or fish, you need to fillet it, right? Now I know, back then I don't know. I don't even know how to make it cook. Because the chicken is thick, the fish is thick. Okay, then I remember when I'm in church, pastor say, do everything in the name of Jesus, surely will work. You want to know how I do? How I serve my first few customers? I hope you are not my first few customers. That's what I do. In Jesus' name, let it be cooked! Business was so bad. 1 month, the sales is $300. Every day, every half an hour, I will go to the cashier and ding, check. Then after that, I'll cry. Then I will go to the cashier again, I will ding, and then I'll cry again. My husband will say, stop crying! Don't cry! You're the head and not the tail! But I'm $300. How to be not the tail, I'm the head. You know, in food court, we have to hand in our sales, right? 25 stores. Every day I hand in, I'm the last one. Then I look up, admiring, how did these people make it? Then I come back to the store, I'll cry. Husband, today I'm last number. Stop crying! Go back there! You're the head and not the tail! I'm the tail, you know? You always say that I'm the head. Okay. Every day, cry and cry and cry. I say, God, why is this thing happening to me? Anyone to know what God said? He said, you say you trust me? I said, yes, I trust you. And then he said, you said you really trust me? I said, yes, I trust you. He said again, you say you really trust me? I said, yes. He said, you trust me with your lips, but your heart are so far away from me. Because if you trust me, you do not worry. Many times in Bible, I say, don't worry. Don't worry. And don't worry. So I say, okay, God, this is my surrender point of time. I say, God, okay, fine. I'm going to trust you. If today I do $300, I'm going to say, thank you, God. If today I do $600, I will say, thank you, Lord. Today, if my business will collapse, and I'll go into bankruptcy, I will say, thank you, Lord. Because that is a commandment to us, to give thanks, not in one circumstances, not in two circumstances, not in good circumstances, but in all circumstances, for this is the will of God concerning us. Amen. So I do that. I stop crying. I stop pressing the cashier every day. Thank you, God. Thank you, Lord. You know what I do? I sing song. Cooking, no business, I sing song. My most favorite worship song, Paul and Lord, what can I do but thank you? What can I do but give my life to you? Hallelujah, hallelujah. That's what I do. My four staff, they're pre-believer. They look at me. This boss, ki xiao liao. Okay, I better quickly resign. I don't know whether I got my salary or not. Okay, morning, in morning, they come, you greet them. Good morning, what can I do but thank you? What can I do but give my life to you? Hallelujah, hallelujah. That's what they did to me. They know how to sing the song. What can I do but thank you? What can I do but give my life to you? Hallelujah, hallelujah. That's what they did to me. But I tell you, the first month, I was 25. The second month, we are 15. The third month, we are number one. The beauty of it is not just to become number one, but the four staff that every day mock at me, what can I do but thank you, what can I do but give my love to you, hallelujah, hallelujah. This is what they say. I have seen that this God that you follow is real. I want to follow the God that you worship. They all became Christian. 6 months later, the landlord gave us another food stall. This time round, again, somebody already collapsed, gave it to us. You want to know what he said? You people have a history, you can make the dead alive. So we give you. Sure, you can make it alive. We make it alive. We became number one there. We continue to grow the business. And then we quit from food court, we opened restaurant. All for one purpose, is to serve God and to extend His kingdom. What do? We give to the poor and needy in Myanmar, Pakistan, Malaysia, Indonesia, whereas Philippines. I'm going to show you some picture what we do. Okay. This is in Philippines. Carry on. This is in Indonesia. What we do is we partner with the local orphanage. Their moms are sold as a bride contract. Were sold as a bride contract to Taiwan. For just $300 when she was 15 years old. At the age of 15, the agent will come and pick them. The nice one will get registered. The nice looking one will get registered and they will make passport. At the age of 16, they will pick them up, say that is a contract bride. Bride is bride. Where got contract bride? Right? They bring them to Taiwan. Some were made prostitute. Some were married to a farmer or retired army people. Okay. So they signed a 3-year lease. So they got married with this 16 years. You know, this 16 years old, they will serve this old man. Serve, if the old man is happy with her, they continue to renew. If the men are not happy with them, they say, I change because this is contract. This is 3 years contract. I have a right to change. I change. When you change, the girl is only what, 19? She dare not to go back. She is so afraid to go back. She is so shameful to go back. Then the agent will take her and give her to another man to serve for another 3 years. By the time she's 24, 25, to them she's old already. Maybe she had a child. She's returned back to this place. It's called Singkawang. We took in the children. We give them food. We give them school. Next. This is in Philippines. Santo Tomas, Davao, up the mountain where Abu Sayyaf is. The school is empty. Why? We interviewed the household. He said that, come to school, hungry. Cannot concentrate. How to come to school? Go outside, go to the market, pickpocket. Sell jagung, sell corn, you know, sell kacang, sell water, still got food to eat. Nobody want to come to school. That's why poor, generation after generation is poor. Like what David has shared with you, education is a very important tool to break the cycle of poverty. So we come up with a program. We say that you come to school, we feed you. If you come to school, you get feeding. So, carry on. Yeah. This is in Myanmar. Their parents want to sell them as pedophile. $1,500 US per child. Up the mountain. This is Lahore. From last year, you have to take an internal flight. Golden Triangle. We save them, we put them in a center, they have parents. We tell them, don't sell them, okay. We school them, we feed them, okay. We give them tuition. Saturday, Sunday, they can go home. But most of them, they don't want to go home because they are too also afraid they will be sold off as a child prostitute. These are just some, okay? This is the things that we do also. In Philippines, we go inside the women prison to set the captive free. When they enter the prison, it is because some are murderer, some are, you know, drugs, some are because they cheat people. And immediately when they went to the prison, their parents, their husband, their kids don't visit them anymore. So we say, Jesus will set you free. Jesus will forgive you. They say, huh? You mean Jesus can forgive me? My own husband, my own parent, my own kids cannot forgive me. You know, we say, yes, Jesus can forgive you, provided if you repent and, you know, do not sin again. Some of them are meant for life in the prison. And this is what they say. Even if I'm here, even if I die as a captive, I know that I died as a free man and a free woman. All glory to Jesus. This is what we do in Olive Vine. We work hard. The profit goes to save. We do not ask for donation. We do not ask people to sponsor us or donation. With the little that we have, we give thanks. We present it to God. Five loaves, two fishes, He multiplied. All glory to God. You have heard about all the success story, right? I'm going to give you another 10 minutes, okay? When you have promotion, you say hallelujah, correct? When from a stall become a restaurant, you say hallelujah, correct? When you are perfect, healthy, you know, have a new Mercedes-Benz, you say hallelujah. Or you have a new bungalow, or you have a, you know, condo, what do you say? Hallelujah, right? But if you're sick, what if bad things happen to you? What if your business fails? What if you have a wayward child? Can you still say hallelujah? Friends, this is the real things. Because whether you are Christian or non-Christian, we are all the same. We are not spared of any trials or affliction as long as we're still living and breathing on this earth. Right? Is it easy to say hallelujah when all is well? It's very easy. Is it easy to say hallelujah when nothing is well? It's difficult. But God say, yes. The Bible say, as a Christian, we make a priority that we say that, God, we want to serve you, we want to do this for you, we want to do that for you. We want to make something that we will please you. But God say, without faith, it is impossible to please God. For he who come to him must believe that he is. He is the Alpha and Omega. He is the beginning and the end. He is our healer. He is our provider. He is everything and anything that we needed in this lifetime. And that's what he said. He is a rewarder for those who diligently seek him. I went through a business failure. I opened a shop in Jakarta. For 1.5 years, I put in so much of investment, it doesn't work. I have to close down. For 1.5 years, I sit down there and I ask God, why this time round you didn't bless me? I remember 8 years ago, you blessed me. But why not this time? For 1.5 years, I spent time asking why. We have to accept there are things that we do not know why, and we don't have to ask why. We have to come to terms with this. For 1.5 years, I have to sit there and recite this. I say that your grace is sufficient for me, for your strength is made perfect in my weakness. You want to know how I grow and know God? It is not during my prosperity time. It is not during when I'm high and up. But it's at that point of time, in my moment of weakest, loneliness, broken, not making money, losing money, I found real joy. I found that indeed Jesus is true as what he say he is, that he is enough. Like what Paul said in the Word of God. He said, what I have gained, I count it as loss as compared to the glory of God. I said, that how is it possible, you know? I lost money. How am I supposed to count it as gain? Where I lost physical money, tangible, that is pain here. And that's what he said. This world is operating on what currency? Dollar? Gold? This is the currency of this world. You want to know what is the currency of heaven? He said, in heaven, the currency that I'm operating on is love. Because God is love. Amen. I'm just going to close this with my husband's testimony. I share with you that he had brain cancer, right? Doctors say surely die. 2004, suddenly vomiting. Okay. Go and see doctor. Doctor say that this is a very rare cancer. It's called endolymphatic sac tumor. You are case number one in Singapore. Your total pun buat ni cun. Correct? The whole world, 50 cases only. You are number 51. Doctors say, need to operate. If not, you will die. Okay? We went for operation. 20 hours of surgery. They saw away the bone. If you touch at the back of your ear, you know that it's hard, right? They saw away the bone, okay? At the 17 hours of surgery, the doctor called me and said that they discovered the cancer has gone and attached in the main artery and is eating the main artery. If I continue to proceed, okay, this patient may come out vegetable. So what do? I say that, you know, you try your best. He was wheeled up, 2004. Doctor say, give your 6 months to live. Okay. 6 months later, he never died. He's still alive. Go back to see the doctor. The doctor say, this cancer will come back. It will relapse. At the most, I give you 1 year to 3 years. You cannot cross this. True enough, 3 years later, in 2007, we went back to see the doctor. Now the cancer is right in the middle of the brain and the ear, and the size is the size of a golf ball. The doctor said that you must do surgery now. If not, you will die. Okay? If you do surgery, I will remove 9, 10, 11 nerves. That means you cannot talk. Okay? Your face will, you know, droop down, and then your eyeballs will roll back. Okay? And you need to go for tube feeding. Okay? He said, that's not my option. Okay? It is very inconvenient because I do mission. I go to all these countries. Very inconvenient for me to eat through tube. Okay? And doctor said that if you don't go for operation, 3 years, surely you will die. 2010, surely you will die. What do we do? That is our situation. They pull through 2010, come 2013. Really cannot already. The size of a cancer has grown 2x. One inside the brain and one outside the brain. 2x. He cannot function anymore. He cannot even walk. He has to lie down on the bed. He cannot go to work. He's just basically just waiting for, you know, his time to go home. We sent him for operation. Friday went in. Just 2013. Friday went in. Friday night, he was pushed out. Saturday night, he was so painful. He practically has lost all the energy. He cannot see. When he see me, he see four of me. And he said that, I think I cannot make it anymore. I know that I want to go home because it's just, I cannot, I have no more energy. I cannot breathe if it is, you know. Saturday night, 12 a.m. in the morning, I was waiting for him at the corner. He suddenly cried and he said, Jesus is here, Jesus is here. And Jesus touched him right here. And Jesus breathed in a new breath of life in his nostril. Suddenly I saw him doing this. And then he fell asleep. That was Saturday night. Sunday morning, we couldn't find him. The nurse pressed the emergency button. Patient lost. We don't know where he is. You don't know where he is. He's in the toilet showering. He said, very hot. I shower. The nurse said, how can it be possible? This is brain cancer surgery. Nobody's supposed to walk 2 weeks. How can you just come down from the bed and you go shower? They quickly called the doctor in. The doctor checked. He said, you are perfectly well. Then he tell the doctor, I want to go home. So we were discharged Monday morning before 12 o'clock, walking, not wheelchair. Three of us walking, me, him, and my daughter, walking out of that hospital. And the nurses and the doctors say, this must be what you Christians say. Miracle. Friends, I do not know what is your struggle today, but I want to share with you, our God is real. He's not just real some 2,000 years ago, but He's still real today. He still touch. He still restore. He still heal. What we need to do, believer, pre-believer, is to press on to believe. Because He said in His word, if we believe, we will see the glory of God. Amen. Let us give all the glory to God.
Thank Thank you, Miss Judith, for sharing. I hope you are truly inspired. Did you guys learn something today? Yes? I really hope you can bring back some of the learnings as well as sharing that Miss Judith has imparted us. Okay, it's time for Q&A, so I invite Miss Judith to take a seat here. Okay, at the same time, I would like to invite David on stage to help facilitate the Q&A. David, please.
Hi friends, let's give a round of applause to Judith again for wonderful presentation. I'm quite sure we are all really inspired by her. There's one thing about God, if you trust Him, if you have faith in Him, He will deliver. And learn from what Judith said. Don't just trust with your lips. Trust with all your heart. He will deliver. Right? Now, I'd like to open to the floor for if you have any questions for Judith or myself. Please feel free to ask anything concerning what she has shared. But of course, anything that you ask, Judith will reserve the right whether to answer or not to answer. But I'm quite sure she'll open to most questions. Yes. Can we just have anyone who wants to? All right. Yeah. There's a lady here. Lady. Yes. Daddy, can you pass to this lady over here? Thanks. Thank you. Thanks.
Hi, Judy. I think I really enjoyed your testimonial earlier. I have a question for you. I've seen many people fall very badly, and they took a lot of time to recover. I know you are a survivor for sure, and I can see that you are very driven. But what made you stand up and just persevere all the way without even slowing down? That I truly admire. And my second question is, by now, I believe your faith in God is tremendous. Please share how you persevere that. Thank you.
For me, in life, we have to agree that there's always a moment of weakness. There's always a moment of, uncertainty and even fear. To say that do not fear, do not worry, and we totally not worry or fear, you know, it can be difficult, yeah. Throughout the 10 years of battling this cancer, and also, you know, a shop have to close down, not doing as well as before. We always hear voice. For my husband, he will hear this. Where is your God? You already serve God. But why is this thing happening to you? You say you're very clever, right? You think you're very clever, right? Can your God even save you? 10 years. This is something real, you know, that you wake up, you are faced with a fact of there is tumor in your brain and it is painful. And even for me, as a wife, I hear voices like, what if your husband died? What if once more you're left alone again? What if your daughter have to be fatherless again? So what do? It is time for us to fight back. How do we fight back? We fight with the Word of God. My husband will say this. You ask me, where's my God? You serious? You ask me, where's my God? My God is right here. And His promise is He will never leave me, nor forsake me. And what do? This is what I say to that voice. You ask me why? You ask me what if? What if not? Come what may, I will choose to praise the Lord, my God, my rock, my redeemer, and the lover of my life, because I know and I know and I know for all things work together for good, for those who love God, and for those who have been called according to His purpose. I don't have to worry so much. I just need to work on my love for God. And I know that all things will be okay at the end. We need to fight back. How do we fight back? The Word of God.
Can we have next question? Anyone like to ask another question?
Don't be shy, huh? Anyone?
Yes, please. Yeah.
Hi, Judith. I really thoroughly enjoyed and very encouraged by what you told us. I don't have a pain like you, but I'm so touched by what you say. But there's one thing I'd like to learn from you is, are there some Bible verses or statements that goes around your head all the time that encourages you every day? That's what I want to learn from you. Thank you.
Yes, I would say in every situation, in every trials or in every pain, God always gave me a verse that I can hang on to. Like for example, the 1.5 year when I go through that my business is not doing well in Indonesia, and how do I fight not to discourage myself further, but to find strength and to find peace in the midst of chaos, in the midst of trouble. That's why this verse is very effective for me within this 1.5 year when I fail in my business, that your grace is sufficient for me, you know. Your strength is made perfect in my weakness. I memorize and I meditate day and night, you know, from morning until night, because the Bible already say in Psalm 1, right? He said that when we meditate day and night, right, then we will be like a tree that planted by the stream of water, right? That even when the season is dry, we will still bear fruit.
Hi, Judith. You really are a survivor. I'm just wondering, you said God talked to you. Is it through the Bible or is it in voices or what? Thank you.
Okay, many people always ask this question, how do you hear from God? Okay, our God is a talking God. In the Bible, He said to us that He will talk to us, right? Like in Jeremiah 33:3, He said, call unto me, right? If you call unto me, I will answer you, and I will show you great and mighty things which you know not of, right? And then even in Psalm 91, okay, the Bible also say that He will call unto me and I will answer to Him, okay? So the fact of the matter is we must know that our God is a God that He can talk to us, okay? Now, number two, how we can hear, okay? This has to be built, a relationship, intimacy. For example, if you have someone that you love so much, even if they are at the other parts of the world, if they call you, hi. If my husband is in Pakistan, if he called me, hello, straight away I recognize. I know he's my husband because he's my deliverer of my soul. How can I don't recognize him? It's a relationship that takes time to build, but it's never too late for us to start building right now. Start from today. Start from tomorrow, take a baby step, and that will grow.
Do we have the next question? Can we have the next question? Okay, if not, maybe Julie, can I just ask you a question? Right, okay. There are believers, most of them are believers in this room, but they are also pre-believers, okay? Basically, what you share with us tonight, would you want to share something with the pre-believers relating to what you've shared? Maybe you want to actually say something to the pre-believers. Yeah.
I was once upon a time a worshipper of all other gods except Jesus. You know, for Medan people, we are very on in worshipping all the you know, Datuk Kong, you know, Kwan Tae Kong, Tae Chu Kong, and all that. But when I was in deep trouble, when I wanted to jump down from 14th floor, I called unto the names of all these gods that I worshipped before. And I asked them to help me, but I received none. But when I call upon the name of Jesus, He come and save me. Because that is what in the Bible. You know, when I was not a Christian back then, I always feel that, you know, there is this emptiness that no matter what I do, nothing can fulfill this. Nothing can fill this emptiness. Be it monetary, be it love, be it relationship, nothing can fill this emptiness. But right now, as a Christian, I'm not talking about monetary, okay? But I'm talking about I can wake up feeling that I'm so joyful, I'm so peaceful, I'm so happy because it's fulfilled right here.
Thank you. Okay. Now, before we close the Q&A, I'd like to share something. Maybe I'll just borrow what Judith shared tonight, and I'll apply it into our topic, leadership, entrepreneurship, wealth creation, to God's wisdom. Now, of course, Judith shared many wonderful things, more than just GIMC. God is in all parts of our life, not just in business. Okay, but I'll have to actually move back into this business point of view, your wealth creation process. I think we are truly enlightened by what she said, inspired by what she said. Like what I told you about 15 minutes ago, I think our faith is a decisive factor that will decide whether you are successful in any wealth creation process that you do, whether you are a businessman, whether you are a manager, whether you are an investor. Your faith. If you have faith in Him, if He say you do, He will straighten the path for you. If you trust Him well enough, not just by lips, but from your heart. Now, let me apply it over here. Now, of course, GIMC is actually a non-profit organization, but let us take it as a business, because we hold seminars, just that we don't go for profit. We hold seminars, we have a purpose. You know? So let me take it as a non-profit business. When I ask God, I'd like to do more for you. God say, GIMC. But God, who am I? Who is David Poe? Why must they come and speak for me? Why do the audience want to come and hear what we say? Who am I? I don't have much resources. Where do I get speakers? Now, but I only know one thing I should say. When God say, I do. And God just open doors for me, door after door. Our first session was even by the Singapore richest man. Speakers after speakers, God just opened doors for us. And we have even people coming to say, David, I'll take care of the premises. David, I'll take care of the food. The resources just come because I trust Him. I trust Him, even though who is David Pope? But Father, you ask me to do, I'll do because it's for you. It's from you, it's for you. And I trust Him. Doors just open by itself. So the same goes for my own business, the commercial and the profitable one. It's the same. If you say, you do, I do. I know if I obey Him, He will straighten the path for me. Likewise for you, right? Now with this, Judy, if you have anything else you want to add on?
I just want to encourage you, okay, that you see that every day we are battling with what we see, what we hear, what we know, versus the Word of God. Right? This is the real challenge every day. Okay? But when we come to this situation, we must know and we must have the confidence not to see the things that we see, not to hear what we hear, but to follow exactly what the Word of God has to say. I do. What the Word of God has to say is the absolute truth. What His promise is absolutely yes and amen. His word is as sure as the sun will rise up tomorrow. Yeah. For example, just now when I share in Proverbs 3:5-6, say I trust the Lord with all my heart, right? But many of us, maybe half-hearted, maybe a little bit, okay. But we need to first, you know, God has a condition. He said that all the blessings I have given to you, but there are conditions to meet all these blessings. Number one, you trust me first with all your heart, right? Number two, you lean not unto your own understanding first, right? Many of us, we need to know why. Why is this thing happening to me? Why am I like that? Why is it not so unfair? Why? You know, every time we come to God, we argue with God, why is this happening to me? Why can't be like that, you know? Why other people are richer than me, but I, you know, serve you more, you know? These are real things that we face every day. But he said, lean not unto your own understanding, right? But in all your ways, you acknowledge him. What does it mean by acknowledging him? Okay. Acknowledging in Hebrew is called yada. It means totally surrendered. Totally saying, yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. Yes, yes, Lord. Whatever you say, I do. Then, he say, I will direct your path. And this is for sure as the sun will rise tomorrow. Amen.
Okay, thank you, Ms. Judith, for addressing our Q&A and your inspiring speech. And also thank you, David, for facilitating the Q&A. Okay, may I now invite David to present a token of appreciation to Ms. Judith. And this token of appreciation is actually a book that inspired the name of our non-profit organization, GIMC, which is God is my CEO. I saw this book in David's office back then in our Topai office, always right on top. And then maybe he has this inspiration from this book. So therefore, today we have the birth of this God is my CEO non-profit organization. So I'd like to, David, to present a token of appreciation to Ms. Judy. Okay, once again, thank you, Ms. Judith and David. It's been a fruitful evening, and I wish your year had been a memorable one. And I speak by faith that our years ahead will be greatly blessed. For closing, can we invite David to lead us in the closing prayer, David?
For those who feel comfortable, please join me for a short prayer. Father, we convey here tonight for a good purpose, for your purpose. Father, we are here to learn from your wisdom in leadership, entrepreneurship, and wealth creation, using your words, using your values. Father, we know that in all things that we do in our wealth creation, the road may not seem smooth ahead. But we know as long as we continue to have faith in you, unbroken faith in you, and we know you straighten the path for us and you light up the path for us, we know you see us through. Father, we continue to pray for your strength and wisdom so that we can if you are an entrepreneur, a manager, employee, or just an investor, we will continue to look forward to you, to use your words
in our wealth creation process. Thank you, Father. In Jesus' precious name, we say thanks and we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Thank you, David. Just a few announcements before we end. Okay, first of all, thank you for taking time to attend this event. I hope you have gained insights and encouraged to apply the way of Christ in work and in life. As some of you may already know, GMC is self-funded by Mr. David Poe as well as a few sponsors. We are at the beginning stage of building up this organization to advance God's kingdom. So if you appreciate and have benefited for the events that we organized so far, do help us in ways you can, either in cash or in kind. Just now there was an SMS that you can send to. If let's say there's any donation you want to make, feel free, or you want to volunteer as well, you can send an SMS to the two numbers. As for the Marketplace Mentorship Program, which you send this number to, we have received an overwhelming, a very good response. So please wait for the confirmation SMS reply before you attend, because otherwise the first session, while we see 100, 200 people to attend. So please wait for the confirmation SMS to before you come for the mentorship Marketplace Mentorship Program by Miss Ashley. Okay? So also we are in need of volunteers, so we would like to thank today for those volunteers who has helped us today, especially staff from Asian Wisdom Group as well as GMC, Keisha, Sally, Doria, Pritam, and also the two volunteers who have approached us, or rather four, Derek, our photographer, Ashley as well, our photographer on the other side. We also have Amy Singh as well as Wena Song, okay, who came earlier to help us to distribute the food to everyone. Okay, we really appreciate it. Can we give the volunteers a big round of applause? Thank you. And did I miss anyone? Oh, no. Okay, no, lucky not. Okay. So, last but not least, do visit the World Vision booth right at the back if you have any inquiries about sponsoring a child or to the least privileged. Okay? Once again, thank you all for attending this event. See you all in future. God bless you. Good night.